Hello. My name is Eliza Sylvia, and I am a graduate student here at the University of Guelph. I would like to welcome you to the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences convocation this afternoon. The University of Guelph is honored by our graduates, and we take great pride in this convocation. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the proceedings today. The ceremonials used for conferring degrees have evolved over a millennium, and the gowns and hoods represent that history. In general, the gowns for the baccalaureate and magisteriate degrees are black in color, and the hood is different for each degree program. The University of Guelph crest that you see on the curtains behind me and shown on the cover of the convocation program also represents our specific history. The emblems in the crest show links with the royal city of Guelph through the white stallion above, the connection to the liberal arts through the book, and to the sciences through the astrolabe, and our connection to abundance and agriculture through the cornucopia. The University of Guelph motto, Rerum cogniscere cosas, is a quote from Virgil. It is variously translated to be either, happy is the one who is able to ascertain the reason of things, or perhaps to know the meaning of things. The procession of people into the hall are also influenced by ancient tradition. The piper will herald the start of the procession of graduates, the students who are coming to graduate today. This will be followed by the arrival of the mace leading the platform party. The mace is a symbol of authority of the university and will be carried by the beadle. In medieval universities, a beadle was chosen by the instructor to work as an assistant. Today, the beadle is a ceremonial officer of Senate. Following the beadle and mace is the vice chancellor, members of the administration, and the honorees, fellows of the university, members of the board and senate, and members of faculty and staff. The degrees will be conferred in the order that you see in your program. The degrees are separated by categories representing the specific degree being awarded within the college. The name reader will present scholars to the vice chancellor by degree category. As the name of each student is called, the beadle will place the hood over the recipient's shoulders. This moment will be videoed, and technology willing, there will be a simultaneous live cast of the event to allow family members and friends to watch from a distance. The vice chancellor will greet each student at the center stage, and a photograph will be taken. We understand the joy and excitement accompanying such an auspicious occasion, but we ask that you hold your applause until after each group of graduates has crossed the stage. There will be opportunity for a truly thunderous applause. Once all the degrees are conferred and all the cheers are cheered, the vice chancellor will close the ceremony and a recessional will play. Please remain standing during the recessional until all the platform party has proceeded out of the hall. Our colleagues from the Alumni Affairs are hosting a social media program developed especially for convocation. Please share your photos, memories, and advice with graduating students by joining us on social media and using the hashtag GuelphGrad. Finally, may I be the first person to congratulate the graduates on their various successes and offer my congratulations to the family and friends who are here to support them. Welcome to the convocation at the University of Guelph.
O Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all of us command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
Friends, let us pause for a moment and reflect with our whole selves, mind, body, and soul, on our unique journeys, our distinct callings, and our place in this complex and mysterious world. In this moment, we acknowledge the Attawandaron people, on whose traditional territory the University of Guelph now stands, and we offer our respect to their Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Métis neighbors. We remember that the world as we experience it is not the world as it has always been. Furthermore, it is not the world as it must always be. In this moment, we give thanks for those friendships that have blessed us over the course of our studies. We are grateful to those who have supported us and held us up, faculty, staff, mentors, and family, for the journey has been long and the traveling hard. I invite you now to embrace a short silence, and in your own way, be it through prayer or remembrance or thoughtful affirming, recognize that for which you are grateful. As we open ourselves to a new season of life, may the knowledge that we have attained here be coupled with wisdom, colored with compassion, and marked with humility. May we embrace each new opportunity in ways that honor creation, that foster community, and that defends the dignity of all people. And may the mystery of life and each new moment bring us laughter and health as we seek to be agents of grace and peace and hope for this world. Amen. You may be seated.
Members of the board, honorary fellows and faculty of the university, family and friends, and graduates, welcome to the celebration of convocation at the University of Guelph. Let me also take this opportunity to extend a particular welcome to this afternoon's convocation speaker, Professor Byron Sheldrick. Delighted to have Byron here with us. My name is Franco Vaccarino, and I have the honor of serving as the President and Vice Chancellor of this great university, and I'm particularly delighted today to welcome all of you to Convocation. Now, to kick things off, first off, graduates, this is your big day. You've worked hard, you've persevered, and you've made it. Well done. Congratulations. So as we begin today's convocation ceremony, let me share some thoughts and words with you. Think fast. Think fast. We've all heard that expression. You don't often hear, though, anyone tell you to think slow. Think slow. But my main message today is twofold. Think fast and think slow. As a psychologist, I'm interested in cognitive science and neuroscience, and speaking as well as a parent of university-age children, actually two daughters that are not far in age from the group here today, I believe your minds are different from those of your parents' generation. We see how you absorb information and how you interact with and through information technologies in very powerful ways. Past generations might see that as just so much distraction and lack of attention. Maybe you hear those kinds of comments when you're on your devices. But that view is actually missing something. Young people today are able to cope with and process more information and attend to more multiple sources of new information and knowledge than any other generation. Your brains have successfully adapted to a fast-paced world, an unprecedented fast-paced world. You know, we talk often about knowledge as a body of knowledge, sea of knowledge. In many ways, the metaphor, I think, in today's world is beginning to evolve and even change a bit. Today, we're navigating a river of knowledge, one that is growing larger and flowing faster all the time. New ideas come at us at an unprecedented pace, new innovations, new ways to connect the dots and understand the world. We need to process more and more information in the same amount of time. We need to think faster. We might call this kind of fast thinking, reactive thinking. Reactive thinking is the kind of thinking that helps a driver negotiate the twists and turns of a road from moment to moment. Very, very important. But there's another kind of thinking, reflective thinking or slow thinking. It takes a broader, more strategic view of problem solving. If you take the road metaphor, reflective thinking enables you to decide whether to take this road or that road, or indeed to reflect on whether or not the road you're on is the best road to be on. There might be a road that's actually less problematic or more effective. In our fast-paced world, universities are increasingly important places for both kinds of thinking. Reactive thinking that addresses today helps us successfully navigate through the fast-paced challenges and opportunities that characterize our world, but also reflective thinking that rises above the here and now to take the long view and the broad view, to consider tomorrow and the day after, and to consider that broader context. And when you consider that broader context, it even affects your fast thinking system. As students at the University of Guelph, you've benefited during the past few years from an environment that has challenged your thinking, an environment that nurtures freedom of thought and expression and inquiry, an environment that promotes and supports openness to new ideas, one that invites varied perspectives, perspective taking, varied perspectives on a problem or an opportunity. We've tried to encourage you to exercise both reactive and reflective thinking. We've stressed the kind of thinking that enables you not just to provide the right answers, which is very important, but also to ask the right questions. And asking the right questions, I believe, that is actually more and more important these days. We've looked to nurture thinking that is disciplined and thinking that is interdisciplinary, that draws upon diverse experiences and points of view. That kind of thinking is even more important in a world where the challenges and opportunities we face are larger and definitely more complex than ever. Big problems, complex problems, need lots of minds thinking together on solutions. And when we bring together these minds, we're not just talking about like minds, but unlike minds. Unlike minds from varied backgrounds and perspectives. You know, it's interesting. I was just chatting earlier today. I'm a real music buff, and I notice on one of my music apps that I keep getting these bubbles saying, you might like this song, or you might, and it's because it's similar to the songs that I would normally listen to. That drives me crazy. I don't want to know more about the songs that I like or that are familiar. I'd be much more interested, actually, in songs that I wouldn't normally be exposed to. So this idea of not just like minds, but unlike minds from varied backgrounds and perspectives is important. Now, and there's a proverb that goes something like this. If you want to go fast, go alone. And if you want to go far, go together. You're about to explore and discover the next phase of your lives. Let me say, go together. Think fast and Think Slow. Thank you very much, and congratulations to all of you. Thank you. Let me now take this opportunity to introduce our convocation speaker, Professor Byron Sheldrick. Professor Sheldrick joined the University of Guelph in 2006 and is a faculty elected member of the Board of Governors, as well as his faculty role. Currently, Dr. Sheldrick is the Associate Dean Academic of the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences, and prior to this, served 9 years as the chair of the Department of Political Science. That "served 9 years" has a certain ring to it, doesn't it? I am now pleased and delighted to invite Dr. Sheldrick up to give today's convocation address. Thank you very much.
Well, you made it. You're here, you're done, and yet at the same time, you are just beginning. And it's going to be an exciting time from here on in. It is a great honor to be here and to be asked to address the graduating class. And certainly, if I reflect back to when I was in your position, I must say every year it gets a little harder to do that. Just, it's dimmer in my memory. But if I reflect back to when I was sitting where you are now at my graduating class, it was 34 years ago, I would never have predicted that I would be here, standing here, wearing this vaguely ridiculous outfit. It is ridiculous, right? It's not vaguely, it's completely ridiculous. Although I do think the hat actually makes the whole ensemble. It works because of the hat. But I never would have thought I would be here addressing a group of accomplished young people as they embark on the next chapter of their life. And I want to speak to you a bit about the value of what you've achieved, the degree you're receiving today, and what lies ahead for you in the future. Of course, we hear much in the media, in the news, and talk shows, in op-ed pieces, in newspapers, about how devalued a university education has become. That it's hard, particularly if you're graduating with a Bachelor of Arts or a degree in the humanities and social sciences, to find jobs without additional training. You're going to be destined to be unemployed or working at Starbucks. It's all a little depressing. I like Starbucks, but it's a little depressing. Well, let me tell you. When I was studying political science at Carleton University in the early 1980s, and I lived at home, and I would go out and I would chat with my dad and his friends who hung out in the garage where they were usually working on a car, and they said, "What are you studying?" And I'd say, "Oh, political science." Well, after the laughter died down, I would hear, "Well, what are you going to do with that? That's kind of useless. What sort of job will it get you? You'll never get a job. What sort of work are you going to get?" And my friends who were studying English literature, history, geography, sociology, anthropology, were all hearing the same things. 30 years on, that group of friends are all employed, they all have jobs, in a range of fascinating careers. Some of them are air traffic controllers, others are university professors, some are police officers, just a huge range of activities. One who I'm particularly envious of manages a jazz festival. That would be better, but it would be really good. So there's just a huge range of opportunities. And just as I could not have predicted that someday I would be standing here speaking to you, they could not have predicted the direction of their careers and of their success. And I might add that several of them this week actually have their own children who are graduating from university as well and are in this position. Certainly, we live in a time when the economy is precarious, but that's also not unique. I went to high school throughout the 1970s, which is a period of profound economic turmoil. throughout the 80s and the early 90s, when I was doing my undergrad and then grad school, the economy was bad, jobs were scarce, and people were genuinely worried about the future. I'm not a Pollyanna. Will be challenges. But you, I would suggest, are ideally placed for success in what comes ahead. For several reasons. And because I'm a social scientist, I like lists. So first, the fact that you are here, graduating today, and there are so many of you, this represents a transformation of educational opportunities in the Western world. I was at the beginning of what proved to be a sea change in opportunities and possibilities. So a bit of background. I said that when I spoke to my father and his friends, it was inevitably in the garage. This is where my father lived, or at least when I was a child, that seemed to be where my father lived, out in the garage, always working on cars. He grew up on a farm in the Ottawa Valley. He left school in grade 6. He learned his trade as a mechanic in the Second World War in the Army. When he came back to Canada, there weren't many jobs. So he worked for the next 30 years in a machine shop, a job he hated. And he did that because that's what was expected. The notion that one could aspire to do what you wanted to do, what you were driven to do, what you dreamed of doing, was simply a foreign concept to him. You simply did what you had to do. My mother, by contrast, was the high educational achiever in our family. She left school in grade 9. And she worked at a variety of jobs, but in general, she cleaned people's houses. And she did that so that my sisters and I could have music lessons, have new clothes at the beginning of a school year, go on field trips, and do all of those sorts of things. And I would add that I think my inspiration to go on in education came from being dragged around, because we didn't have daycare, by my mother to the various houses she cleaned, because I wasn't allowed to touch anything. The only thing I was allowed to touch were books. And houses with National Geographic magazines were the best. So I spent my time reading encyclopedias of science and space and National Geographic and nature and all these sorts of things. And it inspired or created, I think, what I hope is a lifetime love of learning. So certainly in my parents' day, the prospect of going to university, if that was just not an option for them. Even though I think they could have done very well had they had that opportunity. Universities have been transformed. They have moved from institutions of the elite, the select few and the wealthy who could obtain that status, to become institutions of mass education, where opportunities for education have been expanded to all of us. And I, for one, believe that as a society, we are much the better for that change. Enrollments in universities continue to climb. Currently, some data I found suggests that roughly 76% of young people by the age of 21 have entered some sort of post-secondary education, either university or college. And the data also shows that liberal arts graduates, social sciences and humanities, often, while they may start out earning less than their counterparts, if earnings are important, and they are, then their counterparts in science and engineering and professional programs, often over the lifetime of a career, do as well, if not better. And it's particularly true if combined with a graduate degree, but not exclusively. The difficulty, of course, is that as more people have something, the value of it seems less. It becomes devalued in some. If everyone has a BA, it's not that special, is it? Well, I say without reservation that it is still important. It is special. Universities have never been about training for a job, a specific job. If it was, I would have been a politician. That's what my dad's friends all thought when I told them I was studying politics. They said, you want to be a politician? No, I don't want to be a politician. I want to study politics. I don't know what I actually want to do, which confounded them tremendously. They were just mystified by that answer. But it's about developing your sense of identity, broadening your horizons, honing your intellectual capacity. And if I could just reference President Vaccarino's talk, it's about understanding fast thinking and slow thinking. I had a wonderful professor in my second year of my undergrad who said that the answer to every question, and I apologize to anyone who's ever had a class with me because you've heard this story, he said that the answer to every question is some combination of this formula. Yes, but, or no, but. What you have learned is how to think fast to get to yes or no, but slow to critically reflect about the buts. And the buts are often just as important as the initial yes or no. So, universities are about that. They're about becoming the person you want to be. Bright, intelligent, empathetic, and full of potential. And that's where you sit now, full of potential. It doesn't train you to a task, but rather it enables you to realize your potential and enhances your capacity to go out and realize it. And this is why the social sciences are, I think, so valued. The problems we face in our world, and they are complex, are not going to be solved strictly through science or technology. We also have to understand the social, economic, and political dimensions of those problems. We have to combine the creative and critical analytic skills of our humanities and social sciences with technology and a variety of other skill sets. We have to be truly interdisciplinary in our thinking. We have to be fast and slow. We have to understand yes and but. And as I look around and I see a lot of what I think is kind of frightening things in the news these days, intolerance, a lack of respect for diversity, I think kind of the yes and buts are getting lost, or the buts are getting lost. And you, when I look out, are ideally placed to bring that kind of critical reflective piece to debates about the future of our planet, the future of our world, and the solutions that we need to arrive at. So I think the social sciences, the arts, the BA is still very important. So be confident about that. Don't apologize. I once had a conversation a little while ago with someone who was about to graduate, and I said, well, what's your degree? And he said, oh, just a BA. Why? Why just a BA? This is an accomplishment. It is your accomplishment. And you should be incredibly proud of that. It is an accomplishment that you have worked hard for and has placed you in a position now to fulfill and pursue your dreams. I'm going to leave you with two pieces of advice. So, and a confession. The confession is that despite standing here in the funny outfit, I didn't always like doing my readings. Anyone else here in that position? No? So rather than reading political science, I most of the time would have rather read science fiction. I am a total science fiction geek. You're very lucky I haven't already referenced Star Trek, Star Wars, Doctor Who, and a whole other panoply, or universe of, I almost lost my hat, universe of things. So the advice I'm going to leave you comes from Douglas Adams, and I don't know if you know who Douglas Adams is, but he's the author of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which is one of my favorite books. Well, yeah, books. It's a trilogy in four parts, so it's kind of weird, but nevertheless. So Douglas Adams in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy has many, many words of wisdom, but two that I think are particularly important. The first, which is a little strange, is always know where your towel is. And if you're hitchhiking around the galaxy, getting rides on spaceships, you should know where your towel is. This is not really explained in the books, but that's okay. It's a metaphor for being prepared. Always be prepared. Know where your towel is. For you, know that you have the capacity to adapt, to change, to pursue opportunities. Do so with confidence. You have been well trained to do so, and you have the skills and you have the abilities. The second is perhaps more readily apparent what it means. It's simply don't panic. Douglas Adams in his book says that The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy is kind of like a travel book. It's an encyclopedia, electronic encyclopedia, that you take around and you can look up things about where you are visiting. But he tells us that the book is actually full of errors and mistakes. It's rarely updated. It's kind of like an academic textbook. And that there are all sorts of problems with it. He says, but despite that, it's the best-selling book in the history of the galaxy. Because on its cover, it has in big, bold, comforting colors, the words, don't panic. Don't panic, regardless of where life takes you from this point forward. Take the experiences you've enjoyed here with you. Life is going to throw bumps and curves, and the road is not always going to be straight. Don't panic. You will make it. You will. 30 years from now, you may not be standing here in a funny gown, but you will be a success. You will have influence for the better, the people around you, and you will have achieved great things. I am confident of that. So take the experiences you have had here that you have enjoyed. Good luck. I know that someone recently said to me, we often get so focused on the finish line, we forget about the journey. Well, you're at the finish line. I hope the journey was fantastic. But now your task is to set another finish line further out. And I hope you enjoy that journey as much as you did, or perhaps even a little more than you did this one. So good luck and all the best and every success.
Thank you, Dr. Sheldrick, for those inspiring, and now I think I've learned a little more about you as well as my colleague. I'm Charlotte Yates. I'm the Vice President Academic at the University of Guelph, and I have the great honor to, I think, move us to the stage of this ceremony to which you've all been waiting. So I would ask, would the graduating class please all stand? Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars who have fulfilled the statutory requirements laid down by the Senate of the University of Guelph that they may be admitted to their various and several degrees.
By virtue of the authority vested in me and in the University of Guelph, I hereby accept you for admission to your various and several degrees with all the rights, privileges, and obligations appertaining thereto.
Thank you. Will members of the graduating class please be seated?
Good afternoon, I'm Gwen Chapman, and I have the pleasure of serving as the Dean of the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences, and it's a real delight to be here today to congratulate and recognize the graduates from our departments of Geography, Political Science, Sociology and Anthropology, and Psychology. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Arts Honors Program. Laura Paola Alaguna. Nicholas Barris. Chelsea Leith Bartosik. Emily Justine Bowman. Vanessa Bergoglio. Caitlin Ghislaine Diane Brown. Kyle Jared Burns. Monica Carrero. Nicole Carana. Adam Blade Cherney. Jessica Haley Cherendoff with distinction. Jacoby Susan Heather Clark. Nicole Elizabeth Collard. Thomas Vasquez Cortez. Kaylee Ann Coverdale. Emily Annette Cox with distinction. Tiana Micheline DeFritis. Timothy John DePass. Christina Di Giambattista. Natalie Fusillo. Katie Jean Goodall. Megan Elizabeth Goodhand. Amy Katharina Grotelaars. Brittany Kathleen Hall. Ellie Jean Haley Hellier. Rebecca Leslie Jean Howard. Dylan Roger Innes. Sarah Marie Jacobs. Gracie James. Jessica Marion Jameson. Felix Jourdain. Taylor Marie Junkin. Kendall Christina Casper. Taylor Mackenzie Kliss. Kathleen Ann Lammert. Travis Lewis. Meng Chi Lee. Sarah Kai Johnson Luker with distinction. Avery Heather Loopmanis. Taylor McDonald Plummer. Chelsea Mulvale. Samantha Murray. Hannah Nandorfi Fishlin. Alexandria Nort. Paige Jordan Oberfelds with distinction. Alexandra Lynn Parks. Cody Luzar. Rebecca Marie Pereira. Oriana Christina Polo. Allison Elizabeth Rogers. Megan Christine Ross. Ayan Salad with distinction. Blake Schuett. John Alexander Strauss. Amy Kathleen Sweet. Mackenzie Ann Taylor. Michael Randall Sidney Truman. Tara Beth Venator. Felix Volhard. Layla Wabi. Danielle Waters. Nicholas Wensing. Trina Wheeler. Haley Marie Whitehouse. Please join me in congratulating these recipients of the Bachelor of Arts honors. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I now have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences, that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Arts General Program. Jesse Augimeri. Brianna Baird. Rohan Basu. Nicole Braguglio. Hilary Chomiak. Natasha Mary Connolly. Jessica Sierra Cooper. Fiona Marguerite Vitalis Corbett. Jade Savannah Emily Crawford. Carissa Nicole Curlew. Emily Edith Emoff. Maya Elizabeth Ferwerda. Gregory Thomas Galante. Sarah Leon Gerber. Christopher Edward Heasley. Laura Catherine Henning. Patricia Henry. Rachel Gion. Jasmine Carr. Daniel Lucas Crass. Cyrus Lee. Michael Philip Loggin. Alyssa Cody Madeline McDonald. Jacqueline Louise Maisie. Cole Malkinen. Liam Alexander Phil Murray. Madison Patricia Northey. Soraya Olchevsky. Niraj Pillay. Kyle Snar. Kayla Tost. Nyla Catherine White. Taylor Michelle Wilkin. Olivia Helena Zukowski. And please join me in congratulating these recipients of the Bachelor of Arts General Program. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I now have the honor to present to you these scholars from the College of Social and Applied Human Sciences that they may be admitted to the degree Bachelor of Science Honors Program. Maeve Ellen Buckley. Lori Mae Ann D'Souza. Chan Wool Kim. Melody Elizabeth Marquez. Elodie Elizabeth Marquez with distinction. Patrick Snell. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I now have the honor to present to you these scholars that they may be admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Science in Environmental Sciences Honors Program. Matthew David Cummins. Edmund Kenneth Marwa. Please join me in congratulating all of our recipients of the Bachelor of Science degrees.
Mr. Vice Chancellor, I would ask you to confer the various and several degrees on the graduates listed in the program but unable to be present at this ceremony.
By virtue of the authority vested in me and in the University of Guelph, I confer the various and several degrees in absentia on the graduands not present. Well, graduates, you did it. Congratulations. Well done. So let me take this opportunity now to welcome all of you graduates to the Griffin alumni family. This, of course, is a growing family. This week, more than 1,000 new graduates are joining that family, and the University of Guelph alumni now number more than 125,000 graduates around the world. As you can imagine, we're all very, very proud of your accomplishments here at the University of Guelph, and very much look forward to seeing how the foundations that you've developed here as a student will continue to support you in the future. We want to celebrate your achievements and your successes and do hope that you will stay in touch and remember that you're always, always welcome here in your academic home. Graduates, you've made many memories here, including, of course, today's ceremony, and I'd suggest you remember this as well, that you are, of course, a student for a short time, but you're a Griffin forever. So congratulations. Well done. Now, this concludes our formal convocation ceremony, and I will mention that Dean Gwen Chapman will host the tea for all the graduates and their guests in Creelman Hall, and this is an opportunity to congratulate the graduates, and we hope that you can attend, and Creelman Hall, of course, is just behind us here. I think I'm pointing in the right direction, yes. And just a couple of quick items of business. Graduates, once you've taken all your photographs, if you could please remember to return your gowns and hoods to the tent, not to the tent, to the downstairs area where you got them. Now, this is our final ceremony of the week, and I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the many staff members and volunteers who help convocation run smoothly. And as you can imagine, there's all sorts of stuff behind the scenes that has to happen for events like this to run smoothly. And we have an amazing group of staff, an amazing group of volunteers that we are so fortunate to have supporting us. I do want to acknowledge them. I'd also like to give a shout out to our anthem singers, Kieran Kane and Rachel Jones, as well as to our piper, Dr. Bruce McDonald, for leading the academic procession. Dr. Bruce McDonald is, I have to say, it's a special highlight for me when we have these ceremonies. There's something very magical and powerful with our piping coming into these ceremonies. So thank you for that. And now, final words. Convocation is dismissed. Congratulations.